Linda presents this unabridged recording of Great Australian Outback Nursing Stories, written by Bill Swampy Marsh and read by Bill Swampy Marsh and Jacqui Katona. Dedicated to Care Flight NT, Kakadu National Parks Rangers and the nursing and support staff from Jabiru. Thanks for saving my life. Special thanks to senior publisher Brigitte Doyle and editors Rachel Dennis and Lachlan McLean, along with the promotions and sales staff at ABC Books HarperCollins Australia, without whose support these stories may never have seen the light of day. And to my precious support crew of Kath Beecham, Craig Langley and Margaret Worth. Special thanks to Anne-Marie Borchers and Krana Plus for all their help and assistance, and to all those wonderful nurses I met along this journey. You are all just so important.
Contributors. The stories contained in this book are written from interviews recorded by Bill Swampy Marsh. The contributors are Steve Anderson, Anne-Marie Borchers, Andy Cameron, Robin and Keith Carpenter, Barbara Chester, Christopher Cliff, Anton Coleman, Yvette Daly, Diane Few, Nola Gallagher, Stefan Grabdrath, Richard Hempel, Annette Keenan, Michael Lanigan, Rosemary Lynch, Kerry McEwen, Barb Meredith, Sarah Malloy, Glynis Thorpe, Ken and Anne Vickery, Matthew Old, Annette Brown, Marcel Campbell, Chris Carter, Jane Clemson, Francis and Peter Colahan, Shirley Cornelius, Oliver DeLang, Cheryl Fontaine, Glenda Gleason, Bernadette Greensill, Taylor Howard, Donna Lamb, Margaret Loveday, Bill Swampy Marsh, Colin McLennan, Bev Metzen, Chris Smith, Kai Suvato, Margaret Worth, and many, many more. Oh, my heart, it belongs to the land, from the deep blue seas that surround her, to a center of giver and sand. Introduction. Great Australian Outback Nursing Stories is perhaps the toughest book I've written in the Great Australian Stories collection. During my travels, I was taken into places that were not pleasant. Unfortunately, a number of those places included remote Indigenous communities. This was an eye-opener that many white Australians either try to ignore or don't get to see. Those who do see it, like the nurses, the doctors, the teachers and the administrators, as well as the many, many Indigenous people themselves, are courageous and caring beyond belief, and they manage to carry out their work with a hint of that wonderful sense of Aussie humour. Despite their efforts, in 2016, a remote area nurse, Gail Woodford, was killed in the AP Wirelands. A 10-year-old girl committed suicide in a remote community out from Derby, WA. And the unrest continued in a number of communities where some of these stories are set. In fact, our Aboriginal youth suicide rate remains higher than that of every country in the world bar one, Greenland. And while just 3% of our population is Indigenous, the prison population is nearly 25% Indigenous. Added to that, Indigenous life expectancy is 10% lower than that of our non-Indigenous population. A number of nurses I interviewed described the situation in Indigenous communities as being our greatest shame. But I have a strong belief that we as Australians, of all colours and creeds, are able, if willing, to overcome whatever difficulties we're faced with and forge a far stronger, healthier, and more tolerant society. During my travels, I was inspired by an old Indigenous man I met to write the song Old Man Australia.
Oh, my heart belongs to Australia. Oh, my heart, it belongs to the land. From the deep blue seas that surrounds her to a center of giver and sand. And I dream that we all live together, every child, every woman and man. And we all learn to love one another, and together we joined in and we sang. Oh, my heart belongs to Australia. Oh, my heart, it belongs to the land. From the deep blue seas that surround her to a center of giver and sand. And when nighttime shadows have fallen and peace chimes, harmonies ring, then we'll all raise our voices as one voice, and together we'll join in and we'll sing. Oh, my heart, it belongs to Australia. Oh, my heart, it belongs to the land. From the deep blue seas that surround her to the center of giver and sand. And I feel the homeland calling, the Kakadu, the gutsy, the bream. Upon the wind, the dream times are swirling, and the old man whispers to me. Oh, my heart, it belongs to Australia. Oh, my heart, it belongs to the land. From the deep blue seas that surround her to a center of giver and sand. Yes, my heart, it belongs to Australia. Oh, my heart, it belongs to the land. From the deep blue seas that surround her to a center of giver and sand.
Story. G'day, matron. So you want to hear about some of my nursing experiences, do you? Okay, I grew up in New Zealand at Hawke's Bay. I wasn't the best of students, so I left school early. Then one day I was up at the hospital visiting a sick mate, and I saw a male nurse bringing around the supper trolley. Around him was a group of gorgeous young nurses. And that's when I thought, geez, I wouldn't mind a job like that. And it had nothing to do with pushing a meal trolley around. I then sent letters to a few hospitals, and one reply came back asking me to come in for an interview. So I jumped on my motorbike and I went to the hospital, and I remember the lady in charge saying, "Well, you don't look like a suitable candidate, but come back tomorrow and I'll give you something to do for the day. If you still want to be a nurse after that, come and see me again." And I can tell you, she put me in the toughest ward. It was the female medical unit that had all these poor old dears sitting there dribbling into their porridge. Oddly enough, I enjoyed it. So I went back to the lady in charge. "Yeah, I'd love to do this." And she put me into a 3-year training course. That would have been about 40 years ago. I was the only male in the full class of females, which raised some eyebrows, but I stuck at it. Then after I graduated, I went and worked in intensive care. But I had this thing about being a midwife. Problem being, they kept saying, men can't work in female wards, and that made me even more determined. So I came over to Melbourne to do my midwifery course. And after passing with flying colours, I worked in the labour wards at the Queen Victoria Medical Centre. But a few big hospitals later, I thought, nah, this is not really for me. I'd like to try bush nursing. By then, I'd done my Bachelor of Nursing. So when I saw an advertisement for the position as Director of Nursing on Mornington Island, up in the Gulf of Carpentaria, I put in an application and I got the job. That was in 1992, and the plan was to go there for no longer than a year, but I ended up staying for 7. Mornington was a lot different than anywhere I'd worked. It had a population of about 1,100. At the hospital, the ratio of white to the Indigenous employees was about half and half. All the registered nurses, RNs, were white. In those days, there were hardly any Aboriginal RNs. If there were, I would have employed them. Still, we had a good set of Aboriginal cleaners, cooks and groundsmen and that. The hospital was an old fibro-asbestos joint with just 10 beds. The nursing staff stayed in little houses next to the hospital. There was no security fencing in those days. In an attempt to entice the nurses to stay longer at Mornington, I tried to make their lives as comfortable as possible. I made sure they got all their proper entitlements, and I fixed up their accommodation. We had our food supplied, and of course, there were some nice beaches, and the fishing was great. And in the end, most of the RNs were staying, on average, for about 4 years. Oh, that's right. I even organised a vehicle for them. There was one of the nurses and a boyfriend who went camping in the back of her four-wheel drive down at the low tide mark near Birri. And at midnight, when the tide had risen, the boyfriend just happened to get up to go for a pee. And there were fish looking at him in the rear vision mirror. So that was the end of that vehicle. This was back before they had prohibition at Mornington, and a lot of the people blew their welfare checks on grog. And we got the brunt of it, with abandoned children, the beatings, the fighting, the lot. It was so bad that the RFDS, the Royal Flying Doctor Service, once had to make 3 trips within a 24-hour period. The vast majority of the incidents were fueled by alcohol. There were about 20 suicides a year, and all extremely tragic. I'd often be called out to cut someone down from a tree or the like. Not long after I arrived, I got a call around midnight that there'd been a shooting. When I got down there, 2 policemen were trying to revive a young man in someone's backyard. It turned out to be an attempted suicide. I said, nah, it's hopeless. Look, he's put a big hole in his chest. So we decided to take him back to the mortuary. By then a crowd had gathered around us. I suppose it was just a part of their grieving process, but they were so full of frustration and anger that they attacked us with sticks and rocks as we tried to move him, and that was a bit of a nightmare. But generally, the local folk, the Lardils and the Bentings, were quite lovely. I wouldn't have stayed so long otherwise. We had a great public health system with chronic disease management. We did the best we could despite the alcohol. We'd often run sessions at the school promoting a healthy lifestyle. People had good access to specialists down in Brisbane, and we had a number of visiting ophthalmologists, ear, nose and throat people, cardiologists, respiratory physicians and so forth, who'd include us in their wider hospital circuit. Over time, I gained great respect from the people. In the end, I'd say I knew 800 people out of the 1,000 by their first names. Funny thing, though, the locals still called me matron, irrespective of gender. I'd be walking down the street at night to go fishing or whatever, and I'd hear voices coming out from the darkness. G'day, matron. How's things, matron? Anyhow, someone once told me that the best time to leave the party is when you're having the most fun. So after 7 years, I moved on. But Mornington wasn't the easiest of places. I heard later that they went through something like 5 directors of nursing in the next 2 years. Against all odds. I was at the University of Queensland doing a Master of Tropical Health degree when I met a female German medical student. We just run into each other and so, yeah, we got married. That was in the late 90s. After my...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.